This is a topic that's been in the news a lot lately about extrasolar planets. It's a field that didn't exist when I first started going to high school back in the early 1990s, and now has exploded to become arguably the most exciting and most active area of all astrophysics research. So, what I want to tell you about today is how we got to where we are right now. How do we get to the point where we only speculated about the existence of planets around other stars as recently as 25 years ago, and now we're just awash in extrasolar planets, and we're getting closer and closer to finding another Earth. So, first of all, feel free to ask questions at any point in time. Raise your hand, shout out questions, and that's not a problem at all. So here's where we started. This is the long, long ago days before 1989. That's back when these were all the planets in the universe that we knew about. Our own solar system, Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, and Pluto. But we didn't know about these forever. It was really only the inner five or inner six planets that were known since ancient times. And then it was only with the invention of the telescope and then bigger and better telescopes that the outer solar system was discovered. And then we recently made a decision to axe Pluto. If anyone wants to ask questions about that, we can do that later on. But what I want to focus on is that Uranus and Neptune were discovered. They're not visible to the naked eye. And they were discovered because telescopes were invented and better telescopes were invented. And that's really the same story about why we now have tons of planets out there, because our telescopes and our instruments have gotten better and better, and starting around the late 1980s is really when that final leap happened, and the ability to measure very, very small signals from distant objects got good enough for us to see the signature of planets. And this is really kind of a portrayal of what's been going on. This is the total number of planets in the whole universe that we knew about over time. And this is right around the late 1980s, 1990s. And now we know about the 8 planets in our own solar system, plus well over 1,400 planets orbiting other stars. And there's literally thousands of candidate planets out there that are very likely to be real, that will probably be confirmed over the next few years. So I want to tell you how this happens. So, everyone here in general knows that space is big. Everyone knows this, but the key thing that's always important to keep in mind is just how big it is. If this is our Sun, and this is the planet Jupiter, then this is their relative sizes to scale. And that's the size of the planet Earth. Some of you might have seen comparisons like this, but it's important to note. The Sun is 109 times larger than the Earth in terms of its diameter. And if you want to actually see how big space is, then what you can do is you can take the planet Jupiter, and then we're going to shrink all of this down, and I'm going to put the Sun and the planet Jupiter in comparison to each other's size with the planet Jupiter at Mercury's orbit. So I'm going to put Jupiter at the distance from our Sun that Mercury is, the closest planet in our solar system, and this is what happens. The Earth disappears. It's way smaller than a single pixel. And Jupiter and the Sun are this far apart. If Jupiter is super, super close to the Sun, in reality, Jupiter will be way past the house over there in comparison. And so this is the difficulty that we have, because the planets and stars that we're trying to see are so far away that their signals that we can measure from them are so small. So there's several different ways to discover planets. In fact, there's literally over 24 ways that theoretically we can find planets. At least 7 or 8 of them have been successful so far, but we're really dominated by just 3 or 4 methods. And these are the methods I'll tell you about. And this is how we want to think about discovering planets around other stars. The first one that is you naturally think about is just direct imaging. Actually, look at a star and see if you can see the light from a planet next to that star. The reason this is hard is displayed kind of in this diagram over here. This is one of the first directly imaged planetary systems to be discovered. The star is named HR8799. And these 3 different dots here are planets orbiting that star. The reason the star looks like this big, crazy, mottled mess here is because the light from the star has been blocked out using a method called interferometry, where you combine the light and blank it out so that you can block all the light from the star and only leave left over the light from the planets. In this image here, 99.999% of the light of the star has been fully blocked out, and this is the residual 0.0001% that's left. Even so, it's really hard to still see the planets around them. And it's just simply because stars are so much brighter than the planets. Stars are generating their own light. They got thermonuclear reactions in their cores, they're generating a ton of light, and planets are really only seen under the reflected light from their star, or from a little bit of heat energy that they have left over. The reason this shows how difficult this process is that to scale here, this planet D, the one that's closest to the star, is about the same distance from its star as Pluto is from our sun. It's 30 astronomical units, 30 times the distance from the Earth to the sun. If you wanted to try to see a planet the size of the Earth, that would be at Earth's orbit, it would be a tiny little unresolvable blip in the middle here. Also, this planet D here is super bright, because this is actually a pretty young system. The star and the planets have formed within the last few hundred million years, and these planets are still glowing pretty dull red hot from still having leftover heat from forming initially out of all the material. So this is the most extreme situation, the most favorable situation you can imagine, where you've got these really big gas giant planets that are still super hot and super far away from their star. And we still have a really hard time seeing them in the first place. If you wanted to try to see the Earth around the Sun is about 10 billion times brighter than the Earth. So you have to imagine a dot here that was about 100 to 1,000 times fainter, that was 30 times closer to its star, and try to figure to see that. So that's why direct imaging is hard. The other way we can do it is we can actually look for the influence that planets have on their stars. So the typical picture we have of a planet orbiting a star is that the planet goes in a circle while the star stays stationary. But what's really going on is that the planet and the star are both together orbiting the center of mass of the whole system. So in this case, the star is a lot more massive than the planet, so while the planet goes in a big circle like this, the star goes in a little bit of a circle like this. So if we can measure the movement of a star, that helps us infer the presence of a planet. But what is really going on here is you don't see the planet, you only see the star. And then you have to hope that you can calculate the motion of the planet from the motion of the star. This is called the radial velocity method, and it's very similar to imagine a couple of figure skaters spinning around each other, where a more massive figure skater, a larger, heavier one, is holding onto a smaller, lighter one, and so the heavier one is moving in a small circle in the ice, and the lighter one is moving in a larger circle. So the lighter figure skater is the planet, and the bigger one is the star. But what's really going on is that the weight difference or the mass difference between a planet and a star is by a factor of 1,000 to a million. So the best example that we could use with human beings is not, you know, one slightly heavier figure skater than the other, but say something like, you know, a huge sumo wrestler grabbing a tiny little boy and throwing him around. And so through the magic of Google, we can see what that actually looks like. So the sumo wrestler is the star, moving in a tiny little circle as he swings the boy around, which is the planet. But what we're seeing in these cases is only the sumo wrestler. We're not seeing the boy, which represents the planet. We're only seeing the star wobble back and forth. So what happens is we watch these stars, and we watch them very, very carefully. And we can't very easily see movement of the stars side to side or up to down from our line of sight, because measuring the movement is very, very, very difficult, especially if you're below the atmosphere, where the atmosphere is just blurring out the light from the stars. Rather, what we can do is we can measure what's called the radial velocity, the movement of the star towards us and away from us, because the light from the star is Doppler shifted. It's shifted in the same way that a siren from an ambulance or a police car is high-pitched when it's moving towards you and it becomes low-pitched when it's moving away. The same thing happens with light, and so the light is shifted, making it a little bit redder and a little bit bluer as the star moves towards or away from us. And that amount of shifting, a little bit blue and a little bit red, which is extremely exaggerated here, if you measure that carefully over time, you'll get this nice sinusoidal pattern that is being caused by the gravitational movement of the star towards us and away from us as it is being circled by the planet. And of course, in this situation, if the planet was orbiting the star face onto us, like this, there would be no signature whatsoever, because the star would only be moving in the plane of the sky and not towards us or away from us. So this is the radial velocity. Now, if we were to try to discover a planet like our Earth this way, that'd be really, really hard, Because the sun moves at 0.22 miles per hour due to the gravitational pull of the Earth. So right now, I'm walking a lot faster than the sun is moving because of Earth's pull. So if you want to try to detect an Earth-like planet like that, you got to be measuring these stars really, really, really precisely. This is my method. This is my favorite method. This is the one that I use and that has become really, really successful over the past few years. And it's called the transit method. And this takes advantage of a very fortunate configuration because the stars that are being orbited by planets out there in space are all randomly oriented. All evidence that we have so far suggests that stars in their solar systems have random orientations in space. And so a few of them will be oriented just precisely enough and just lucky enough so that as the planet orbits the star, some of the planets will cross the face of their star as they go around, and when they do so, they will block some of the light from the star. So if you can measure the brightness of the star over time and see these dips in brightness that are caused by the planet blocking the star, you can use that to detect a planet. And what's especially exciting about this is that if you use this method, you can see how long it takes for the planet to start going across the face of the star and then stop going across the face of the star, the duration of this ingress and egress. And what's so exciting about that is that tells you how large the planet is. Not just how massive it is, how much stuff there is, but how large it is physically. So if you use this method to discover a planet that's transiting, then you watch the transit, you can measure the diameter, and then you can also measure the wobble of the star, because any star in this configuration is always going to be wobbling towards you or away from you, and that tells you the mass. And if you've got the mass of the planet, and you've got the diameter of the planet, then you can combine that, those two pieces of information to get the density. And if you know the density of the planet, then you know what it's made out of. Because we can know the difference between the density of gas, of water, of ice, of rock, or of metal. So that's the kind of a calculation that we can do, knowing nothing about, or measuring nothing directly about the stuff that the planet's made out of, but to get an overall sense for its bulk density and its bulk composition. So that's why this is so exciting. What's so difficult about this is that in a perfect situation, the best way that these things can be configured to detect them is that the planet, if the planet is a big gas giant planet like Jupiter, and the star is a regular G-type star like our Sun, then the difference in sizes between the planet and the star is different by a factor of 10. Jupiter is about 10 times smaller than our Sun. And the amount of light that is blocked is proportional to the area of both of them, so it's the radius squared, so that's 1%. 1/100th of the light of the star is blocked by the planet. That's in the best configuration. If it's a terrestrial type planet like our Earth, and you're trying to detect a planet like that, then the Earth is 10 times smaller than Jupiter, so if you square that, then that becomes not 1%, but 0.01%. So that's why this is hard. We have to have very, very precise telescopes and cameras to measure amounts of light and changes in amounts of light that are significantly better than 1% or 0.1% or 0.01%. So this is kind of an example of what it actually looks like. This is an example from our own solar system a few years ago when the planet Venus transited our Sun from our viewpoint on Earth. So if you have to think about imagining what you're seeing here is this disk of the star, but we can't resolve it. All we see is the total amount of light. So imagine you're staring at this with your glasses just covered in Vaseline or something like that, and you just see a blur. So you have to tell the difference between a blur that's this amount of light and a blur like this with that little chunk of light taken away, and to tell that difference in brightness. This method has become extremely powerful because of this mission called Kepler. Kepler is a NASA satellite that was launched in 2009, and it was unlike a telescope like the Hubble telescope or the Spitzer telescope. This was built for one purpose. This telescope was built for this mission to determine this quantity Eta sub Earth, the frequency of Earth-like planets in the habitable zones of Sun-like stars. It was built to figure out is our planet alone, not necessarily are we alone as living beings, but is the Earth a unique planet, or are there lots of planets like the Earth out there? When Kepler was launched, this was a pretty well-defined idea. We were looking to figure out how common planets are, size, mass, and orbit were around stars like our sun. As a result of Kepler's launch, this entire statement, almost every single word of the statement, is now very, very controversial. We are no longer, have a consensus about what makes a sun-like star. We're really debating about what makes a habitable zone around a star. We're seriously debating the difference between planets and other bodies in solar systems. And frequency as a concept has started becoming a pretty ill-defined. Because what happens if you have one planet orbiting two stars, or if you have many planets orbiting one star, or if you have double planets orbiting a star, or many other configurations? So now what's happening is now that we've started discovering the immense diversity of planets, we're really having a hard time coming up with basic numbers for what these things, how to describe these things. So what I want to tell you about now are some of the discovery highlights. We got a lot of news stories coming out all the time saying, oh, there's this most Earth-like planet, or this largest planet, or the smallest one, or whatever. I want to tell you some of the most exciting things we've found from studying these planets, as well as what is our picture of the set of planets in our galaxy right now. So, one of the first big surprises when planets first started being discovered in the mid-90s is that we expected a lot of the planets out there to be somewhat like planets in our solar system. to have a bunch of terrestrial-type planets, Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars, which are basically big balls of metal and rock. I mean, the fact that we have an atmosphere and ocean is trivial. Almost our entire planet is made up of metal and rock. And that's the case for all of them. So we've got these planets that are orbiting. It takes about anywhere from 100 to a few hundred days for these planets to orbit the star. And then, a lot further out, we have the big gas giant planets. Well, the first planets that were discovered, some of the first, completely upended this paradigm. Some of the first planets that were discovered were so-called hot Jupiters. And if we zoom in to the star way inside the orbit of Mercury, then what we started finding were planets, big gas giant planets like Jupiter and Saturn, sitting right next to the star. These planets would take 3 or 4 or 5 days to orbit their star. Their surface temperatures of these were over 2,000 degrees Celsius. It was a huge problem. First of all, because there was nothing like that in our own solar system, so we're like, what the heck? Why are there, these kinds of planets out there? Also, there's no way to form a planet this close to a star. If you try to assemble an amount of gas or rock or anything this close to the star, the sun is going to vaporize and sublimate before it has a chance to get together. Once it's actually formed, it can live next to the star because its own self-gravity will hold it together. But you have to get it together in the first place, and you can't do that right there next to the star. We not only discovered gas giant planets like that, we're starting to discover rocky planets like that. This is my favorite planet so far. This is Kepler 78b. It is a planet that is it's very similar to the size and mass of the Earth. It's a little bit larger than the Earth, by a little bit. And it's a little bit more massive, 1.8 Earth masses, but not much more. It's basically made out of rock and metal, just like our own planet. The difference is, this planet takes 8 hours to go around its star. 8 hours. It's so close to the star, the surface temperature of this planet is a whole different regime. On our planet, the sun shines on the Earth. It heats up parts of the atmosphere. Some parts of the atmosphere are shielded by clouds, some are not. So you've got air currents that circulate. This planet is so hot that, first of all, the surface, which is made of some sort of rock, we haven't directly measured it, but at this density, it's got to be some sort of rock made out of the silicates that make up the rocks on our all around us. Those rocks, whatever they're made out of, are going to be molten. This whole surface has got to be lava. But not only that, there's different kinds of materials that go into rock. Some of them are really hard stuff that has slightly higher melting temperatures, but some of them will have lower melting temperatures, the silicates, the stuff that makes up sand and sandstone. Those materials have lower melting temperatures. They also have lower boiling temperatures. We can calculate very carefully just how hot the surface of the planet has to be based on how much light is coming to it from its star, which we can measure very precisely. We know that the temperature here is not only so hot that all the rocks are going to be molten, but that the silicate materials are going to be completely vaporized. So the silicate materials over here, the sand, is going to be vaporized into the atmosphere. But just like on Earth, when you got hot air rising and then cool air falling, that creates winds. So you're going to have winds constantly flowing from the near side of this planet to the far side. When they get to the far side, they're no longer being shined on, they're no longer being heated up as much. It's still going to be hot, the rock is still going to be molten, but the silicates that have evaporated into the atmosphere and been blown around are going to cool off enough that they can go back into the liquid form instead of the solid form. So you're going to have an eternal rain of glass on the far side of this planet, permanently, because this planet is locked so that one face always faces the star and the other is always away from the star. And you're constantly having silicate materials being blown around and raining out as a rain of glass on the backside of that planet. There's some other things that we found that we don't have in our own solar system, and this is a big, this was also a big surprise. We got these things called super Earths. In our solar system, we have gas giants. So this is the relative size of Jupiter. This is the relative size of Neptune. So we've got Jupiter, Saturn's smaller than Jupiter, but they're both big gas giants. They're mostly made out of hydrogen with a significant amount of helium, and then smaller cores made out of heavier materials. We got Neptune and Uranus that are about that size. They're mostly made out of ices like methane and ammonia. And then we've got Earth-like planets like Venus and Earth, and then smaller Mercury and Mars that are this size. We don't have anything in our solar system that's about that size. Things that are about twice the size of Earth, that are between the size of Neptune and Uranus on the one hand, and Earth and Venus on the other. We know that a planet this big can really only be made out of hydrogen. It can't really be done to create a planet this big made out of, say, rock. It can't be done, for reasons that we can get into if you want to ask about. Planets this size also can't really be made almost entirely out of rock, or at least we've never seen any. All planets that we've seen like this, whose bulk density we can measure, in general, they're as dense as ices, methane, ammonia, carbon dioxide, water. Planets this size can really only be made out of rock. They don't have enough mass to hold on to a lot of hydrogen, a big hydrogen atmosphere, because that stuff would just escape. We don't have enough surface gravity. Stuff like this can be made out of almost anything. They can be made out of a core of rock and metal and a big envelope of hydrogen and helium gas, or maybe they can be a water world or an ocean world with a smaller core of rock and metal and be made out of water ice, or they can be maybe expanded versions of our own planet, although probably not that much expanded. We think that theoretically that there's a dividing line around 1.75 times as large as the Earth. If you get larger than that, it's really, really hard not to have a big envelope of hydrogen, helium, or ices on top of that, because that stuff is just going to coalesce gravitationally very, very quickly. But we're finding tons of these. We're finding huge numbers of super Earths. Right now, they seem to be the most common kind of planet out there. So we really start needing to figure out what these things are made of. So in our own solar system, we've got certain types of planets. Right here, I'm plotting the size of the planet. So we've got our smaller terrestrial planets like Mars and Earth, and then the ice giants like Neptune, and the big gas giants like Jupiter, and I'm doing the same thing here for mass. So over down here, things that are really small radius and have a larger range of masses, these are iron spheres. That's basically our planet Mercury. Mercury is basically a big ball of iron. It's got a layer of rock on top, but its core is huge. It's basically a solid sphere of iron. Slightly larger than that, are the terrestrial planets, basically an iron or metal, mostly iron nickel core, and then a mantle, a large mantle, of rock on top of that, silicates, magnesium, other things like that that are making what we typically think of as rock. Then what we're now finding are things that are about the size of a terrestrial planet, but a little bit less massive, that are denser. Those would be the water ice worlds. And we're starting to find things that we think fall into this regime. And they're really exciting because we don't have any of those in our solar system. This would be something that, say, has a core maybe the size of Mercury or Mars, and then a layer several hundred miles or kilometers thick on top of that of ices. And those ices, again, could be water, carbon dioxide, ammonia, methane, things like that. Then there's these so-called super Earths that I was just telling you about. We're finding tons of them, and they can be almost any combination of stuff. And then there's the water and ice giants, things like Neptune, things that have a small core of rock and metal, but basically are just mostly ice on top of them. And then there's these Jovian gas giants, big gas giant planets like Jupiter and Saturn that are that size, but now we're also finding these so-called inflated gas giants. Things that are the same mass as Jupiter, but really, really inflated. Inflated, they're maybe larger by a factor of two, or 50% to 100% larger, but because a 10% increase in, a factor of two increase in radius is a factor of eight decrease in density, these things are super under-dense. They're super low mass for their size. They're way less dense than styrofoam, put it that way. And the big mystery is, why do we have these four types of planets in our solar system, but we don't have any of these? We know that there's a bunch of these out there. We know there's huge numbers of these out there. We think there might be a decent number of these out there, but they're a little bit harder to find, so we're not sure yet. And then there's everyone's favorite binary planets. Many of you as amateur astronomers might know, when you look into the sky, most of the points of light you see are not stars. They're binary stars. About 50% of the points of light that you see when you look into space are two binary stars orbiting each other, but they're so close together from our perspective that you can't distinguish the one from the other without a reasonably sized telescope. A lot of them are so-called wide binaries. To the naked eye, you can't see that there's two stars, but to even a small telescope, you can tell that there's two stars there. So we're starting to find all these planets out there, so you gotta wonder, well, a lot of them must be in binary star systems, right? And the answer is yes. We found well over four or five dozen of these so-called wide binary planets. We've got two stars that are orbiting each other. They're far apart. They're hundreds or thousands of astronomical units apart. So the outer star takes maybe 10, 20,000 years to orbit the other one, and then this star has a planet orbiting every few weeks or months or years. So you got a lot of these. These aren't that big of a mystery because we think that the way planets form isn't really sensitive to a star that's, although close in the scheme of the universe, isn't that close enough to really affect the orbits of the planets there. The big mystery is the opposite case, the so-called tight binaries. These are stars that are so close together that they're orbiting very fast. So the two stars orbit each other every few days or every few weeks. And if those two stars have a planet that's orbiting the common pair, then that's called a circumbinary planet. And we've found about a dozen of these so far. There was really no way of getting around it. They're called the Tatooine planets. That was going to be inevitable, because if you're standing on that planet, you would see two suns rise in the sunrise. This is a big mystery. Not a mystery because it can't exist, but it's hard to come up with an easy way to form these planets without disrupting their orbits. Or a bigger question for the question about looking for life, how do you define a habitable zone for a planet like this? We usually think of the habitable zone as the distance from the star that a planet could live where it was cool enough for water to exist in a liquid state and not hot so hot that it would boil away and not too so cold that it would freeze over. But this planet is constantly having a changing amount of radiation and light and heat coming from that star. So these binary planets are really, really cool also. So one thing that's really interesting to think about is that one of the... I hope this isn't the wrong slide deck. All right. One of the things about this is that the fact that we're seeing a lot of these things, a lot of these hot Jupiters, big gas giant planets that shouldn't be able to form where they form, the fact that we see a lot of planets that are in eccentric or inclined orbits, planets that are in these really oval-shaped orbits, or these orbits that are really inclined with respect to the plane of their star's spin, that is suggesting to us that planet formation is a very violent and chaotic process. It's not a nice, smooth, even thing where every planet stays in its little home and then just forms on its own. But rather that as planets form, they collide together, they get too close to each other and gravitationally sling each other away. Some theories say that for every planet that we see, at least 10 more planets have been formed in that solar system, and that most of them have actually been thrown into the star through gravitational interactions that just crashes some of these planets into the stars and vaporizes them. And a decent number, a small number, but it's still a decent number, have been completely expelled from their solar system and been flung out. If that happens, we should have tons of these so-called free-floating or rogue planets. Planets that are not orbiting a star, but are orbiting between the stars. And through a method of planet discovery called microlensing, we've started to find them. There's been at least 8 found so far, and we believe that with an upcoming mission that should launch in 2024, roughly, we should be able to find many thousands of them, which will only be the tip of the total number there. In fact, if we take the admittedly small number that we found and we extrapolate, which is always a dangerous thing, then it's hard to come to the conclusion that the total number of these in our galaxy is less than about 200 billion in our own little galaxy. Most of the planets in our own galaxy are probably these rogue or free-floating planets. Okay, so now let me tell you about the broad picture of what's going on out there. This is what Kepler has found. There's a lot of things about planets that are not known. There's a lot of stuff that I've told you that we know about so far, but we're not sure kind of what the intrinsic frequency or number are. But here's what I can tell you that you can take to the bank. These are things that we have no reason to believe are going to be proved to be wrong, because they have survived a lot of statistical tests and we've got a lot of evidence for it. First of all, planets are common. Planets are the norm. They're not the exception. Most stars, most regular stars, main sequence stars, they're called, have planets. Gas-giant planets are relatively rare. There's still a ton of them out there, but they seem to be significantly less common than the smaller planets, the Neptunes and the super-Earths and the terrestrial planets. Planets mostly come in packs. If you see one, there's going to be more. Most planetary systems appear to be multi-planetary systems, kind of like our solar system. The small stars, the red dwarf stars, also known as M dwarf stars, seem to be significantly more likely to have planets. They don't seem to have any gas giants. There's almost no red dwarf stars that have a Jupiter-type planet orbiting them, but they are just packed with small rocky planets, the terrestrials, the super-Earth planets. They're really, really likely to have planets. And as far as we can tell, this is a little bit less certain, but I'd say this is accurate to within say 10 to 20%, about half of all red dwarf stars seem to have a small planet, a planet smaller than twice the size of Earth, in its habitable zone by a conventional definition of the habitable zone. What this probably means is that the first time that we discover a planet, an Earth-sized planet in the habitable zone that is the closest one to the Earth, that we can try directly observing with large, really sophisticated telescopes, it's probably not going to be a planet orbiting a yellow star like our sun. It's going to be a planet orbiting the habitable zone of a red dwarf star. And we're really having to think hard about what we would do about looking for habitability on a planet like that. All right, now this is my part. I work on KELT. KELT is the kilodegree extremely little telescope. There's a tradition in astronomy of naming telescopes after their sizes, so you get the VLT, the very large telescope, the TMT, the 30-meter telescope, the GMT, the giant Magellan telescope, names like that. We decided to go in the other direction and call ours, name it by how little it was. This is a telescope. It's not a conventional telescope. It's a, for those of you who are actually astronomers, you'll notice that this isn't what we normally think of as a telescope. This is a telephoto lens. It's refracting. It's just a lens. There's no mirror in it. It is a fully robotic telescope, and what we do is we use this to scan the sky constantly in order to look for transiting planets. Remember, I showed you that graphic earlier of a star being dimmed by a planet going in front of it. That's the method that we're using to discover transiting planets. The aperture, the width of that lens, is 4.5 centimeters. This is a 2-inch aperture telescope. And that's okay for us, because we don't need to have a big aperture because we're looking at really bright stars. So we don't care about being able to measure really faint things. What we want to do is we want to measure very bright stars and really, really precisely. We want to measure a ton of light from these bright stars. But in order to look at bright stars aren't concentrated in the sky very well. You look up and you can see them just spread all across the sky. So that means we need a really large field of view. We need to look at a really big chunk of the sky at once. And so we've got a 26 by 26 degree field of view for our telescope. The big advantage is a lot of this stuff is basically off the shelf. The lens cost about $1,000, the mount cost about $10,000 to $15,000, the camera's the most expensive part, that costs about $25,000. But this is a chump change compared to what a large, really big telescope costs. This is $60,000. The building costs a little bit more, but still we're talking about pretty small for a scientific project. There's two telescopes. There's KELT North in Arizona, and there's KELT South in South Africa. And they're jointly run by Lehigh University over here, and then Ohio State and Vanderbilt Universities. This, hopefully I can get this to actually work. There we go. This is what kelp salad looks like in operation. This is a time lapse of you over many hours of operation. The telescope, let's see if I can go back to it again. Hey! So the telescope is constantly slewing around, looking at one field after another on the sky, and that's all it does. It just looks continuously at the same set of stars across the sky, night after night, year after year. And it's building up a record of how bright those stars are over time, so that we can go back into the data and look to see if any of these stars showed a little dip in their light every 3 days, or 5 days, or 7 days, or 10 days. To give you an idea of how big 26 degrees is on the sky, some of you might have looked at other telescopes, this is one of our fields of view. Each pixel, this is a 4K by 4K camera, each pixel is 23 arc seconds across. And to put that in perspective, this little smudge down here is the Andromeda Galaxy. Tiny on our field. And we have these big focal plane distortions. You can sort of see that the images of stars are shaped like triangles. And that's true. We have to try to use our software to calculate the brightness of each of these tiny little dots on this image. Every single image where we've got thousands and thousands of images. And we have to measure the brightness of each of these dots to a precision of better than 1%, if we're going to hope to see a 1% dip in the brightness of that dot. The way we do it is with this method called image subtraction. This is what you normally see when you look at the sky. This is what a regular telescope sees. This is what kelp sees. It's the same patch of sky, same set of stars. You can see that. We're just slightly blurrier with kelp. The thing is, if we can calculate exactly how bright each of those blobs are on here and then subtract it off the image, then we can calculate the residuals. How much is left over after how bright we calculate the star should be? And then when we do that, anything that's changing in brightness pops out like a sore thumb. And that's how we see the presence of, well, ultimately that's how we discover planets. It's also how we can find tons of variable stars and all kinds of things that are going bump in the sky. We also have a really large follow-up collaboration. The way we work is the kelp telescopes are constantly measuring about 3 million stars. Periodically, we go through that data set, and then we search a chunk of that data to see if there's any transiting planets. We'll start off with an image that you saw earlier that's got maybe 100,000 stars in it. We'll go through all 100,000 stars, analyze their light, and we'll come up with maybe 500 things that look like it's a regular periodic transiting planet event. Then what we need to do is we have to go back at it with a really big telescope, some 10-inch or 11-inch or 12-inch telescope, like you might be used to, and then measure it more precisely. Because while we can measure things very precisely with over a huge field on the sky, a larger telescope is still better at measuring precisely the brightness of a single star. So what we do is we collaborate with people with larger telescopes all over the world. There's a ton of schools in places in the US, a bunch in Europe, we've got a whole bunch of collaborators in Australia. Some of them are small colleges, some of them are larger research universities, a whole lot of them are amateur astronomers. And these are places with telescopes of sizes about 10 to 32 inches that they make available so that what they will do is they'll look at our list of possible planet candidates and then they'll go out and they'll observe that planet candidate on a given night and they'll say, I can see that's not actually the star that you thought was having a transit, it's actually an eclipsing binary a few arc seconds away. Or they'll tell us, that's just a blip, there's nothing going on, that star is just solid as a rock. Or they'll tell us, oh wait, we actually see an event that looks very similar to a transiting planet, we should go and observe this a lot more. So some of the people who do this are places like Westminster College Observatory. This is Westminster College in Western PA. It's a small undergrad-only school, and they've got a 14-inch Celestron telescope. But that's all we need. And you don't have to be in Australia or Chile or Arizona, because you don't need perfect skies to just measure a fairly bright star. And the stars that we're looking at are fairly bright. So these are examples of what, so Tom Overs is a professor there, and here are a couple of his students, Sam Mellon and Ryan Avril. Sam Mellon actually just moved up to University of Rochester. And what they do here is they look at the light curves of a particular KELT target, and this one happens to be something we call KELT-4. This is actually a discovered planet that we're going to publish and announce in about 3 weeks. So that's going to be exciting. And this is what they see. This is what a transiting planet looks like. All the black dots are their individual observations, and they can see this star dimming by a little bit more than 1%, about 1.5% on these three different nights. And then, as I said, we've got a lot of amateur astronomers. Some of them have really beautiful big setups. This is Mark Manor in Tennessee. He's got a gorgeous CDK-700 telescope. It's one of these like $250 million telescope. This guy's a retired lawyer. He's not doing anything with his time aside from just playing around with astronomical toys. But he's doing done a ton of great observations for us, helping us to discover several of our planets. We got people like T.G. Tan in Perth, Australia, who's got a great telescope. It's only, I think this is only a 12-inch telescope. But he gets gorgeous images, because in order to get very precise measurements of stars, you don't need a really big telescope necessarily. You just need to know your own telescope really, really well. You need to know all its quirks, all its eccentricities. But when you do that, you can get a ton of great, beautiful data. And then we've got people like Yao Gregorio, who's really kind of the epitome of this. He's got a 12-inch telescope here, and for those of you who might know about magnitudes, he can get, he's detected eclipsing events that are only 2 millimagnitudes deep with a 12-inch telescope, which I've never heard of anyone doing that before. So there's a lot of great stuff that we're doing with a whole lot of amateurs around the world, and it's to become a great network for involving everyone in this process of discovery. So to show you what it actually looks like, so this is the schematic. This is the picture that we had for a planet going in front of a star. So this is the light curve. This is the measure of the brightness of the star across time. And this, what I'm going to show you here, is going to be an image of this event here, this schematic, only with real data from our telescope. And what I'm going to show you is it's going to start off black, and then it's going to start populating with individual dots. And those individual dots each are the brightness of that star in one of those huge images measured across time. And the dots are going to start populating there, there, and there, because the light curve is wrapped in time. So it's going to be, you know, say, 1 day to 4 days, or sorry, 0 to 4 days. And then as it goes through time, as we observe, you know, 1 day, and then we're clouded out for a week, and then we observe again, those dots start appearing and appearing. And you're going to see a countdown of how many dots there are, which is each a separate observation, over a certain number of days. So let's see what that looks like. Oh, shit. Oh, it was beautiful. I promise you it was going to be beautiful. It was going to be slowly populating. Anyway, this is what it looks like. These black points are our individual observations, and the red is just the average of those, and you can see it pops out beautifully. This planet is KELT-2AB. It's orbiting a V equals 8.7 star. The depth of this transit is only 5 millimagnitudes. That's half of 1%. So it's a small transit. The planet itself is a somewhat inflated Jupiter gas giant planet in an orbital period of about 4 days. Its surface temperature is 1700 degrees Kelvin. It's pretty hot. And this is what it looks like when our follow-up collaborators do this. So we start off with this. This is what KELT sees, but it's measuring this for hundreds of thousands of stars all over the sky. And then we go back with our amateur astronomer telescopes, and they measure these beautiful, very nice, very well-structured light curves to help us measure the planet's radius and the orbital period. And then we go back with radial velocity telescopes to measure the mass. Now I'm going to get into the topic of looking for life on other planets. We've just started this whole process. This whole scientific field is significantly younger than I am. Although I guess I'm not so young anymore. But for a long time, people were wondering what you can actually do if you discover planets. And this is a philosopher, and I apologize if I butcher the French, Auguste Comte, I think. And he had this very interesting statement when he was considering this philosophical idea of what could we do if we ever were to discover planets or other stars, maybe could we know anything about their inhabitants. And he said, "We see how we may determine their forms, their distances, their bulk, and their motions." He's talking about the planets. We can see their gross properties, but we can never know anything of their chemical or mineralogical nature or structure, and much less of organized beings living on their surface. All physical, chemical, physiological, and social researches are out of the question in regard to the planets. He said this in 1853. At that time, he was right. This was literally impossible to do any of those kinds of things. Fortunately, something changed. In the early 1900s, quantum mechanics was discovered. And the relevance of quantum mechanics is that allows us to look at a source of light from a large distance and break down that light into its constituent colors and determine what that thing is made out of. If that thing is shining through reflection, we can tell what that reflective surface is made out of. Or even more exciting, if the thing is emitting light from its own radiation, like our sun does in the visible light, or how all of us do in the infrared light. If we were to take an infrared picture, we'd all be shining brightly. And the particular colors of that light tell us about the temperature of that thing, but also what it's made out of. So the really exciting thing that we want to do with these planets that we're discovering from KELT, these are all gas giant planets. They're not going to have living things on them. But what we can do is develop the science of transmission spectroscopy. If you've got a star with a planet right in front of it, most of the light from the star is going to come directly from the star to our telescope, and that's just going to look like the star. About 1% of the light of the star is going to be blocked by the planet, and it'll just stop there. It'll be blocked, it'll refract or absorb in the planet's atmosphere, and nothing will happen. A tiny, way less than 1% amount of that light is going to come through the outer layers of that planet's atmosphere and be filtered through that atmosphere and then emerge from the other side and come to us. But after it emerges, it's going to be physically imprinted with the colors of the molecules and atoms that are in that planet's atmosphere. And by measuring that and breaking it down into its constituent colors, and differentiating that light from the light coming from the star, we can directly measure the atmosphere composition of these planets. And eventually, this is what we need to be able to do in order to analyze the light coming to us from distant planets, especially once we can do this for terrestrial-sized planets, and directly probe for biomarkers. Probe for the presence of chemicals that will tell us whether there's life on those planets. This is how we're going to get there. This is the TESS mission, the Transiting Exoplanet Survey Satellite. This is a NASA mission that is being designed and built right now. It's going to launch in 2017, and I like to think of it as KELT in space. It's basically a bunch of KELT-type lenses in a satellite that's going to be orbiting between the Earth and the Moon, and it's going to detect the presence of transiting planets over the entire sky, because Kepler only pointed in one part of the sky. It was configured that way just to get the best measurements. TESS is going to be different. It's going to measure over the entire sky, and it's going to detect planets detect planets the size of the Earth around very bright, very nearby stars to us. Those are going to be the targets that we're going to develop the transmission spectroscopy for to look for the light from the stars filter through those planets' atmospheres and see if we can detect life on those planets, see if we can see biomarkers. This is some technical stuff about the particular types of stars it's going to observe, bright stars across the sky. A lot of M dwarfs, a lot of these red dwarf stars with transiting planets that I mentioned, it's going to be a lot of those. And that's going to get us to the point of really searching for extraterrestrial life. This is the brass ring. One of the main reasons we're trying to do this, we want to find what we would consider a Earth duplicate or an Earth analog. Now, that's not because we believe that life can only exist on Earth-like planets. It's because we can barely manage to describe the kind of life that we have on Earth. We've got a huge diversity of life in all kinds of forms, all these different kingdoms and types, all different shapes, sizes, metabolisms. Some of them live in rocks, some of them live at the bottom of the ocean. So we already have a huge diversity of life on Earth. So all we're trying to do is limit ourselves, basically, as like they say with the drunk looking for his keys under the lamppost. We're going to look there just because that's where we can see it. Doesn't mean that that's where the keys are, but that's just where we can look. So we're going to look for life in the kinds of places where we think we would at least have a chance of being able to describe whether there's life there if we see it. What we want to find is this. A planet orbiting a star with a solid surface. We think we need a solid surface because the chemical reactions that lead to life tend to need to happen near some sort of solid substrate. Otherwise, the chance of those chemical reactions taking place is too small. It needs to have an atmosphere. We think that liquid water is crucial for life, at least as far as all kinds of life as we know it. Water is a very special molecule that's able to act in a lot of unique ways that we have not found any other kind of material acting in. And so we think that it is required for the chemical reactions to take place for life to exist in. So you gotta need an atmosphere, and you need the atmosphere there to provide enough pressure for the water to be in liquid form, as opposed to solid or gas. We think, this is a little bit more debatable, but we think it should have a magnetic field. And that's not really a requirement, but we really depend on our magnetic field to deflect large amounts of charged particles that would otherwise be hitting the Earth coming from the sun or coming from out of space. Without our magnetic field, we'd all have cancer within 12 hours. And any living thing would have its DNA destroyed very, very quickly from those kinds of charged particles. Now, maybe you could still have life living underneath the surface where it's shielded from those particles, but it's still something you kind of like to have. And finally, you need to have it in a habitable zone, again, the distance from the star, so that you could have liquid water. You need the right temperature and the right pressure for water to exist. That's the atmosphere, and that's the habitable zone. So ultimately, what we're trying to do is to go from these initial detections of planets using these wobbles, using these transiting events, to finally being able to directly measure life on the planet and to tell whether there's living things there. We're going to start off by discovering planets through radial velocity, through transits. That's been done. We found thousands of planets that way. We then want to measure their atmospheres through this transmission spectroscopy, or in another way, through emission spectroscopy, looking for light radiating from them. This can generally only be done using transiting planets. That's being done right now. That's in process. We're doing that with a reasonably small number of planets. The next stage is we want to directly image a habitable zone planet. We not just want to see its shadow and see the imprint of its atmosphere on the light from the star. We actually want a picture of it. That's going to be tough. That's something that we're currently working on plans for a mission to do that will deliver for us an image of a planet that will be about 1 to 3 pixels across at best. But if we can do that, that's a great way to measure directly the spectroscopy of the planet. If we're lucky with that, that'll happen with the so-called HAVEX mission, which, if everything goes very well and Congress doesn't want to cut NASA anymore, that will happen sometime in the 2030s. Then eventually we want a resolved image of that planet. We want not only a few pixels, we actually want a picture. We want to see coastlines and vegetation and clouds and storms and who knows what else. No one knows when that's going to happen. We've got some ideas, we don't have the money. So, this is where we're at now. We've got these small dark shadows. We're detecting these planets and we're starting to probe them by looking at the shadows of the planets across the faces of their stars. But what we want to do next is go from the small dark shadows to directly imaging planets, but not with these huge, hot, distant gas giants, but an actual Earth-like planet around a sun-like star. In order to do that, we need to be able to see the so-called pale blue dot. And the pale blue dot is visible right here. This background that we see here, some of you might have already recognized it. This is a picture from the Voyager spacecraft that was launched in the 1970s. And one of the principal scientists on the Voyager mission, Carl Sagan, decided, hey, at some point, let's turn the spacecraft around and look back at the Earth. This happened, I think, somewhere around the orbit of Neptune, but I'm not sure exactly where. These streaks that you see are light being refracted around the side of the side of the baffle of the lens or something like that. But I had a telescope, and I looked, and it saw the Earth sitting there as a single pixel, pale blue dot. But that's all we need in order to break down the spectroscopic imprint of the light from that dot to tell whether we're seeing things like oxygen or ozone or other markers that would indicate life. So that's what we want to get. We can get there. It can be done. There's no theoretical reason it can't be done. What we need is something like a set of telescopes that would be in space. About each telescope will be about 6 to 8 meters across. They would have to fly in formation so that they're connected, so that you can combine all of their light together in this process of interferometry to measure direct picture of a Earth-like planet. The technical side is hard, but it's nothing that's theoretically impossible. It's nothing really that couldn't be done. We just need the money, and we don't have the money. But it's nice to think about, and eventually maybe our great-grandchildren will decide that this is something worth doing. But ultimately, we're working right now on these kinds of telescopes. This is the Kelt South telescope in South Africa against the nice sunset. And what we're doing with this is trying to start the process. We're starting the process of discovering these planets and developing these skills that our later generations are going to need to actually search for life elsewhere in the universe and to decide whether we're alone or not. And ultimately, one thing that's really important to say is that everything that's being done here is being done through through grants and research funds from our governments. This is not happening through philanthropy. It's not happening through patronage. About 95 to 98% of all of astronomy is being done through government support. It's being done because we've so far decided as a society that this is something worth doing, that it's a valuable thing to do. But I don't think any of us should ever take it for granted that this is something that's not absolutely crucial for the survival of our species. Is something that we think elevates us as people and is worth doing. And I think that every time we think about doing this research, we should all be aware that all of our fellow citizens and all of our fellow taxpayers are funding this research and are paying for it to allow people like me, which I'm extremely grateful for, to be able to spend time doing this kind of science and making these discoveries. And so I just want to close this for all of you to say thank you, and I appreciate this, and hopefully I've convinced you that this is a worthwhile use of your hard-earned tax dollars. So, I'll finish there. And I'm happy to take questions and hang out, or whatever we want to do.
Yes, question time.
Question time. Yes?
You mentioned that planets
that
have the last screen now.
Oh yeah, a couple of 78, yeah.
That would be the dark side.
Mm-hmm.
Well, would it seem like it would pile up there for a while?
It's gonna melt, so it's gonna fall down, but it's still gonna be liquid once it falls. And eventually, as it gets heavier and heavier, it's gonna start flowing. So you're also gonna have not only a rain on the atmosphere, but you're gonna have a flow constantly on the surface of the molten material towards the near side to balance out the gravitational force.
Well, if I was getting at it, would it possibly just build up if it's cold enough on that other side, wouldn't it sort of get trapped having a terminal?
It couldn't do that because before that would happen, so first of all, it would have to be able to actually solidify and prevent flow. We don't think it's possible for it to get cold enough for that. You're going to have enough heat transfer just through conduction through that rocky layer to keep that molten. But even if it did, eventually you'd have. Actually, that's a good question. If it were to stay solid on the far side, I don't know what would happen next. It wouldn't get heavy enough to turn over. I think what you'd have would be some sort of imbalance in the weather patterns that would kind of stop that from happening, but I'm not sure. I haven't thought through that. That's a good question.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay, I have two questions.
Sure.
The second one is kind of off the wall, but the first one. Have any extrasolar planets been observed around population 2 or metal poor stars?
So stars, so we can classify stars in different ways. Some of them have about the metallicity of our sun. They have the certain composition of materials of our sun, and those are so-called population 1 stars. There's also very metal poor stars. We think those are very old stars that formed at least, I'm going to say, 8 to 10 billion years ago, during the first kind of third of the universe. And they are called population 2 stars. They don't have many metals, because all the metals in our universe were formed during the first generations of stars. And so it's natural to ask, you know, since planets in general are made out of metals, they're made out of anything other than hydrogen and helium, you know, are there any planets? The answer is, I think the most metal-poor star around which a confirmed planet has been detected, I want to say has a metallicity of something like -1 to -1.5, which is a measure that's basically saying it's significantly less metal-rich than our sun by a factor of 10. I don't think that places it as a true population 2 star. But the big problem is there aren't that many population 2 stars near us. Most of the stars that we can easily see in the sky, the bright ones that are easy to probe for planets, are population 1. That's just because that's their population around here. So, but that's a good question. I think one thing that we're going to want to do very soon is to start developing our tools to start doing exactly that, looking for planets in unusual populations. One thing I can say is that there has been a planet discovered around a star whose evolutionary type, it's basically its position in its evolutionary sequence, shows that it's, that, that star is at least 9 to 10 billion years old. 9 to 10 giga years. I don't think it's quite as metal poor as a true population 2 star, but it's fairly metal poor. And that tells us at least that planets were forming fairly early on in the universe. So there's no reason to believe that it should take 13 billion years, that's about the age of our universe. There's no reason to think it should take that long for planets to form. We already see planets around stars that we think have been around for significantly longer than our own solar system.
And the second question is kind of one which is a little bit off the wall.
That's fine.
You spoke of expelled planets.
Yes.
Apparently just drifting off.
Yeah.
And becoming very, very cold.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any possibility that the missing mass
the dark matter?
Explained by a significant portion of that be accounted for by expelled?
So this is the problem of dark matter. So this is the fact that it looks like most of the matter in our universe cannot be seen with our telescopes. It does not seem to emit radiation, and it's non-detectable so far, but only through its gravitational influence. We can tell that the galaxies that we look at have to be about 10 times more massive than they seem to be if we just add up the mass of all the stars. There were two theories that came out early on that were competing for explaining the dark matter, and they were oddly called WIMPs and MACHOs. WIMPs stands for Weakly Interacting Massive Particles. That's the idea that the dark matter is basically made out of very small subatomic particles that we haven't discovered yet. Some kind of special particle that has mass, but for some reason that we think probably doesn't fit within our standard model of physics, doesn't interact with the electromagnetic force, and therefore doesn't emit light and doesn't absorb light. The alternative explanation was MACHOs, massive compact halo objects. And that basically meant something that was a bunch of mass in a small place, whether it be a cold planet or some star that for whatever reason wasn't shining, or maybe black holes. And that was a serious competitor for the explanation for dark matter. There is a process called microlensing. Microlensing, that's how actually a lot of these rogue planets, the old rogue planets that we've found so far have been found. That's a process of looking for a compact massive thing, whether it's a planet or a star or a black hole, drifting through space and coming between our line of sight between us and a background star and bending the light from that star so that it magnifies and makes it look a lot brighter. And there's a lot of surveys that have been done using this technique, and they found lots of stars and planets also using this technique. But the reason that it started off was to look for these MACHOs. People were thinking, look, if you're going to have a ton of things that are the mass of planets or stars or many times the mass of stars, but they're really dark, well, at very least, if we can see their gravitational influence on the rotations of galaxies, we should be able to see their gravitational microlensing. The surveys have been done. They've been done very exhaustively and very conclusively. And although we can't say very much about the total numbers of the planets, if you were to take the total amount of mass and divide it into these so-called massive objects and then throw these massive objects into the galaxy, they should be way more detected than they are now. Basically, at the limits that you can place from these microlensing surveys, any of these things should cause literally thousands of times more microlensing events than we actually see. So we believe that we've got really strong constraints showing that there aren't all that. So for instance, in order to explain this through these so-called MACHOs, you gotta have literally 10 or 100 times more stars out there than we see. And we do not see 10 to 100 times more microlensing events than we would have expected, given only stars being these things. WIMPs would not cause microlensing events, but the MACHOs would. And these rogue planets would be considered a type of MACHO, massive compact object. So the short answer is, people definitely thought about that, but the microlensing surveys have fairly conclusively ruled it out. Yeah?
You said in the beginning they found a lot of hot Jupiters near the star.
Yes.
Now the hot parts are relevant. Because if you have a heavy lump near a star, it's going to pull on the star more.
Yes.
You said the Earth doesn't pull on the sun much.
Yeah.
You're going to get more of a pull. You're going to see the star wiggling around as it goes around the galaxy.
Mm-hmm.
So why would they have been surprised? I would think it's like an observational bias.
No, you're absolutely, it's an enormous observational bias.
I would think the first thing they'd see is not Jupiter.
Right. So if you expect there to be planets evenly distributed across all areas of the orbit, then you absolutely would expect to see those. But the thing is, early on, we didn't think that you could have a big gas giant anywhere close to a star. That was the thing. And you're absolutely right. Let me kind of go through that. But that's the idea. We thought that we would see other solar systems like our own, and Jupiter only pulls our sun by enough to move it, you know. I mean, we could detect a Jupiter in a Jupiter orbit around the sun, but no one expected to see a Jupiter right next to a star. So that's why. But you're right. It is absolutely a selection bias. These are the first planets found. Now we know that they're actually very, very rare. They're rarer than regular, you know, regular planets, the lower mass planets or the further out planets, by factors of 100 to 1,000. But since they're by far the easiest to find, those are the first ones that were found. It just is a selection bias. So, any other questions? All right. Well, thank you very much for having me. I'll have